Well, thanks to the First Minister, to John and Mary for inviting me. It's a special pleasure for me to be here. I might start by saying how excited I was to come to Cardiff and why I selected that as my choice for which, in which city I could speak. I've not been to Cardiff before, which was one reason. And the second and more important one has to do with something the First Minister mentioned, which is that many of you will know that the Chancellor here is Sir Martin Evans. He received the Nobel Prize for, I could say, the invention or the discovery of an embryonic stem cell. And you'll see during my talk just how foundational that work was, begun by a scientist thinking about basic biology, how does nature work? And then I'm hoping to convince you today that it has something to do with how we might use that information to change human nature. So again, thanks to Mary and John for having me. It's a real pleasure to be here. And it's nice to see a diverse audience. I prepared a sort of general talk on stem cells and medicine. I'm going to make an argument, as it were, today that stem cells will lead to the possibility of longer and healthier lives. And I'll give a few examples of that. I begin maybe by pointing out that we're very lucky to live in an era where we now understand quite a lot about how our bodies are made and maintained. That information is going to give us, I will suggest, a kind of mastery or dominion over cells and tissues. Almost, you might say, a kind of biological alchemy, the possibility of controlling what cells become, controlling what tissues you have in your body and how long they last. And this will change what it means to be a human being. Now, of course, the scope and the arc of biology is much longer than the scope or the arc of changes in finance or sport or politics. And it's often difficult for people to appreciate how these changes, which aren't widely discussed, can have such a long-term effect. And I'm going to end my lecture talking about healthy aging through the use of stem cell biology. So the structure for my talk is to give a little background or context for this work, and then speak about what stem cells are, how they're related to a process called cloning. I'm going to give examples of using stem cells to replace tissues in the body, to use stem cells to understand the causes of degenerative disease, and to look for drugs that could slow the process of degeneration. And then I'll finish, as I said, on the idea of aging. So you can start thinking now about how long you'd like to live and how stem cells might affect that. Where I teach at Harvard University, I've learned over the years, even though I'm the chairman of a medical school department, that I don't like teaching medical students, particularly in the US, because they're really just interested in knowing what they need to know for the test and how to get an A. And so I largely lecture to freshmen. I like to lecture to the first year students. But that has one complication, which I'm accustomed to, is that most of them, while they're listening to me, unlike you as I see, also have their notebook or their phone out and are ordering something on eBay or chatting on Facebook. And so I'll consider it a great success if you can listen to me for 45 minutes and not order something on eBay. I fail usually with the Harvard students. So let me begin then by putting this in context. This is a sort of a Whiggish kind of history to just say, in many ways in the 20th century, biology focused on the gene and DNA. From the time of Mendel's peas at the very beginning of the last century to the discovery of DNA as the stuff of inheritance in the 1920s, to the famous double helix in 1953, to the sequence of the genome really marking the end of the century, it's not surprising that many people believe that DNA is really the stuff of life. My mother, I think, would take the view that the reason she is overweight is because of her genes. She would say that she can't help it. It's all in her genes. Many of you will know, of course, that the genes set the constraints on what we are, but they don't determine the phenotype. And I would further add, of course, that as a biologist, the unit of life is not really the gene, but the unit of life is the cell. And so I'll make, as I said, the case today that the century in which we now live will usher in advances in regenerative medicine, and that stem cells will really be at the center of both discovery and application. And then again, to come back to thank Professor Evans, it was really his insight that thought of the power of getting control over a cell that had this potential, which I'll describe for you today. This general area of biology, by way of introduction, is called developmental biology. And developmental biologists in general ask the question, how does an egg become an adult? How does the cytoplasm and the genes, how do they interact? How do cells become different? How do you make an animal? And that was, in my view, much of the subject of interest for developmental biologists for, say, the previous three or four decades. And that related to an issue called cell differentiation, again, something obvious to everyone, that a fertilized egg as a single cell divides to make a ball of cells. Those cells have to become different from one another so that you have the different tissues and patterns we see in our body. So an experiment I'd like to begin with, largely because I think, at least in the States, it has a bad reputation, is cloning. Why would scientists ever set off to clone? Was it some egomaniacal idea that one wanted to make more people? No, the reason cloning was done was to answer this question, that is, a fertilized egg makes an adult, how do cells become different from one another? And my favorite picture of this, this test by cloning, is shown here. It's an experiment done in the 1960s by John Gurdon, in which a cell from a mating of these two albino frogs, the nucleus from such a cell was transplanted into an enucleated egg of this mother frog, giving rise to this, I've forgotten the number, I think there are about 30 genetically identical frogs there. And one of the things you can point out, which I like to point out to my mother, is that that frog is very little and that one is very big. And so it proves that it isn't all just about the genes, because all of these frogs have the same genetic background. So this experiment, which was very important because it revealed the potential that all the cells, or nearly all the cells in our bodies, have retained all the genetic information, was awarded with a Nobel Prize very recently to John Gurdon, here on the left, and for a related experiment to Shinya Yamanaka, which I'll discuss a little later. But I wanted to show John's picture again today and relate it back to the Marshall Scholarship, because I don't know how to say it other than it changed my life as a Marshall Scholar to be a PhD student with John. He taught me a way of thinking, I like to believe, and a kind of habit of mind about how to approach science. And everything I've enjoyed in my career since then, I really attribute to the 3 years I spent as a PhD student with John, which was, of course, before I think most of you were born. But I mention it to you to think about your time here as a Marshall Scholar, that it can really have a determining or definitive effect on what you do in your life. And I was glad that the First Minister made note of the fact that this does establish a durable and really permanent relationship between me and Cambridge in the UK. Well, back to the science of this cloning. Not many people except scientists paid much attention to this experiment, but most everyone knows about this experiment, which followed on some time later. And many of you will know that other animals have been cloned since the time of Dolly. Here's just a few pictures of some funny examples. They're funny to me, I'll tell you, because I learned something by reading about this. This is the first cloning of a dog. This is an unusual one here where this female horse gave rise to her own identical clone. So if you like, she gave rise to her twin sister. I might see how I put the lights down a little bit. Yes. Yeah, that's better. This here is interesting. It taught me a bit about farming. I was wondering why people would clone cows, since we seem to have plenty of cows. It turns out that I was born and raised in Chicago, nowhere near cows, and I learned that a very good milk cow can produce 20 to 30 gallons of milk a day. I just find that a stunning number. But when that is true, you want to breed that cow, which would take several years. But instead of breeding it, you can immediately get then in one generation a clone of high milk producers. There are other animals that have been cloned. In terms of numbers, none compared to mice. Sir Evans might know the number of mice that have been cloned. It must be in the tens of thousands by now. But these are the animals that have been cloned, monkeys most recently. But for today's talk, the important conclusion shown here really on the top is this shows that many cells in your body have this astounding potential that can be unlocked to make other kinds of cells in your body. Said more technically there, it just says that the nuclei of some adult specialized or differentiated cells can be reprogrammed to become potent stem cells that can do other things. So from cloning, one learns about the potential in cells, and I now want to move from that, not so much about how do we have our bodies made, how do we make tissues and organs, but rather how are they maintained. And again, this will be known to many of you, that the differentiated cells in your body are not static. They turn over, but at different rates. So I think intestinal cells probably turn over at the fastest rate, which is, of course, a very good thing if you like to eat hot Indian or Mexican food or something. It's a good thing that your intestine is constantly being replenished. I know the data in mice better than humans. I think it's about a half-life of about a week for a human intestinal epithelial cell. Blood cells last about 10 weeks, and everyone, pretty much even non-scientists, know that we have a blood stem cell found in the bone marrow, which replenishes our blood, so that when you're generous enough to go to a blood drive, you don't imagine that you are in permanent deficit for blood. Your body tops up the blood level after using a hematopoietic or bone marrow stem cell. The organ of interest to me, which you'll hear more than you maybe want to about the pancreas, has cells that are very long-lived. Their half-lives are probably on the order of a half a year. And it is true what you're generally told is that your brain cells are nearly permanent. At least where I went to high school in Chicago, they told us that all the time, that if you drink alcohol, you'll kill brain cells and you'll never get them again, not noting that we probably have many cells we're not using, and so we can do with a few less. Just thinking about this turnover rate, I was trying to think, for the non-scientists, how to impress you on the fact that your body is turning over. A couple of ways you might think about it is that when you looked in the mirror today, you had no trouble recognizing yourself. But if you were looking with cellular resolution, there are many new cells on your face, that your face isn't permanent. It's constantly being turned over by new skin epithelia. Another way, if I can remember the number, is there's an astounding rate of turnover in the blood. I think the number would be something like, if you fall asleep now and don't do anything during the rest of my talk, and if I were to ramble on for a half hour, you will be making 3 billion blood cells in that time. Not million, but billion. So you can feel very productive in that sense. So what's responsible for this turnover? Well, in general, stem cells are responsible. And stem cells have two properties that are useful for today's talk. The first is when a stem cell divides, it can make an exact copy of itself, which should make one think about self-renewal or regeneration or replenishment. And from the time of Professor Evans' work and others, we're getting a better and better understanding of the processes which make that possible. How is it possible to make exact copies, to replicate cells? But one of the daughter cells, as it's called, of a stem cell can also go on to give rise to the various specialized cells in our body, bone, blood, muscle, etc. So this makes a stem cell, in theory, a very valuable and interesting kind of cell. And as I've already said, the importance of this discovery was noted by scientists some time ago, but awarded a Nobel Prize in 2007 to Professor Evans. Since that time, others, including many laboratories, have gone on to isolate stem cells from different organisms, and I won't cover all of those, but it's again well known to the public that the most controversial of these is deriving human embryonic stem cells from leftover material from an IVF clinic. And the process shown here shows that the early stage of development, this cleavage stage, grows into a ball or sphere of cells, the inner portion of which can be used to derive a human embryonic stem cell line. And so the point I want to emphasize here, which I've said, is that human embryonic stem cells, as Professor Evans had demonstrated for mouse embryonic stem cells, have the capacity to make any cell type in the body. So for those of you who are my age, I would say that's an astounding claim. When I was an undergraduate, if someone had said there's a cell that can make any human tissue and you can grow it in a dish, I sort of would have fallen off my chair. One of the wonderful things about science is that what seems like magic now becomes sort of ordinary after a period of years of discovery and further development. And so I'm going to spend my talk now building on this basic biological finding, the existence of stem cells, to talk about how they might be used. And again, to repeat, I'm going to talk about it in three areas, some of which may be obvious. The first are diseases in which a particular kind of cell is missing. Can we use these cells to replace or replenish them? Second, maybe a little less obvious, is to use stem cells to understand the root causes of degenerative diseases. And then thirdly, to go back to this idea of renewal and replenishment, think about how do we use this biology to challenge the idea we more or less all live with, which is that aging is inevitable. Why is that so, and what would it mean to live a longer and healthier life? So the diseases I'm going to speak about can be put into these big buckets. This is the part where my wife says I get extremely depressing. She doesn't like when I talk to audiences about this, but there are a number of ways I could make you depressed about looking at this list. One way might be if you live to be 60, it's almost inconceivable that you or one of your loved ones will not suffer from one of these diseases. Many of you will know the percentages better than I, but as one ages, the probability of suffering from one of these diseases goes up. These diseases have a couple of things in common, though, from a biological perspective. First, in every case, these diseases are, generally speaking, the result of more than one gene. So back to this idea that genes are everything, it's not true. It's the set of genes you inherit from your parents which will incline you with a certain probability to get one of these diseases. But to make it more complicated, there is also, in general, an unknown environmental factor. The reason that's essential, and the reason I can say that, is that there are numerous cases for all of these diseases where there are identical twins, one of which has the disease and the other doesn't, demonstrating for certain that there's some other factor involved in the development of the disease. The last thing they all have in common is that, to a first approximation, it's fair to say that in each case, these diseases can be viewed as a problem with a single type of cell. In Alzheimer's, it's really forebrain basal neurons. In Parkinson's, right here, straight down in the mid of the brain, in the substantia nigra, a cell that makes dopamine, a dopaminergic neuron. For ALS, it's the motor neuron. For cardiovascular disease, a little more complicated, admittedly, it would be endothelial cells and cardiomyocytes. And the disease that I'm most interested in is diabetes. And I'm going to use diabetes as an example and just tell you a little bit about advances in the other cases. So diabetes could be introduced again by trying to frighten you with numbers. I don't actually know all the numbers worldwide. I don't keep up on them. But I do know that the cost to the US healthcare system last year of treating diabetes and its complications was more than $224 billion. Not million, billion dollars. The number of diabetics is on the increase for reasons unknown. Another way to think about it, and I'm sorry I don't know the Welsh numbers, I know the numbers for the US, is that at the present rate of onset in the United States, 1 in 300 newborns will be fully insulin dependent by the age of 18. So this is, you could say, a kind of tsunami attacking our healthcare system, not to mention the cost it is to the person who suffers from the disease. And there are two types of diabetes, which I'll explain a bit more about later, but in both of them, they involve a deficiency or a defect in this cell here shown in blue, which is a cell called a pancreatic beta cell, or I guess I should say beta cell, and this cell makes a well-known hormone called insulin. The other cells shown here in this pancreatic islet make these other four hormones, but it's the production of insulin which leads to defects in type 2 or adult onset diabetes. And in the case of type 1 or autoimmune diabetes, it's the absence of that cell, which I show here kind of in the picture, where these cells are destroyed by an autoimmune attack. So a high school student could say, well, you just told us about a cell that can make any cell in the body, and now you're telling us about a disease where there's a cell missing. So how do you connect those dots? And I'm going to talk about that today, making the argument that what we've proposed to do is going to be a disruptive technology on this industry of making insulin. So I thought I'd just say a bit about the industry of making insulin. Insulin was discovered in the 1920s and then for many decades was purified from pigs, sheep, and cows. There I found a picture from the 1920s of 2 tons of pig parts, which were used to purify about 8 ounces of pork insulin. This changed then in the latter part of the century, where insulin was cloned by Genentech in 78. And then 3 companies, Eli Lilly, Novo Nordisk, and Sanofi, have been developing more and better human insulins. I'm making here an economic argument of two kinds, really. One is those three companies now make about $20 billion a year selling insulin. When one hears about blockbuster drugs, insulin isn't even mentioned. It's practically a commodity. And they make that money by just continuing to turn the crank and selling it. And if you think about it, if you weren't concerned about the human cost, it's a nearly perfect drug. If a child needs insulin for the rest of their life and they have to take it every day, that's a pretty good product to have them depend on. Another way to just think about this, though, is that there have been no real advances in the last century, and I'm exaggerating here, of course, but there have been no real advances after the discovery of insulin and its cloning and production of human insulin. So it's now, by now, obvious to you all that I'm going to talk about a different idea for how to treat diabetes, and that is, instead of having a patient prick their finger and measure the amount of sugar in their blood so that they know how much insulin to inject every day, one would provide the cell that does both of those things. It's the cell's, or the body's, factory that accurately measures blood glucose and squirts out the right amount of insulin. And this is the simplest way to show our project. It begins with an embryonic stem cell or an induced pluripotent stem cell. And then we have to educate that cell first to become part of the gut tube. That's the tube that runs from your mouth to your anus and would include your esophagus, your stomach, your liver, your intestines, the pancreas. We then have to tell the cells to become pancreatic, then endocrine, and then finally beta cell. And there are a number of ways of me talking about this picture. I've been showing this kind of picture for more than a decade. It's taken us more than 15 years to solve what looks like a really simple puzzle. In fact, the people in the lab call this my Skittle diagram. It's a challenge because we had to learn about the fates of these cells at all stages of development, learn which genes were turned on and off at the various stages, and then try, as I said at the beginning, to gain some mastery or control over that. And as the embryonic stem cell developed, tell it not to become bone, blood, muscle, or nerve, but to become endoderm, for example. Then tell it what part of the endoderm. And after this 15 years, we've recently published this, which is way too detailed for a talk like this, but to just show you in a rough outline what is involved. So we begin with a human stem cell here, and then each D here refers to the number of days. And so if you add up the days in a 30 to 40 day protocol, we add a mixture, a combination of chemicals, which are both proteins and small molecules, which affect signaling pathways that tell the cell what it should do. And by telling it what to do, I mean telling it which genes to turn on and off. So a couple of things to say about this protocol. First is, it is almost certainly not the only way to do this. There's not a unique answer to this. It's more like cooking, and you can get a very good kind of recipe or cake to make something. This is the way we've done it. I expect now that it's known how to do it, others will improve on this. It would be great if we could improve on both the time and the cost of materials. But we've spent most of our time making sure that we could make this cell here in the bottom right, which stands for stem cell-derived beta cell. And I'm going to just show you a couple of pictures that make us confident that we've made the right kind of cell. Most of the evidence we have involves gene expression analysis. Everyone who comes to my lab wants to do single cell sequencing and transcriptional arrays. But another way to just think about proving that you've made the right cell is, does it look like the right cell? And so here I'm just showing you a very unique specialized granule that's found in the beta cell called an insulin granule. And here across the bottom, this is a primary beta cell from a human cadaver. And this is a classic kind of insulin granule. It's got a white halo around crystallized insulin. This crystal forms in combination with zinc. And these are the crystallized insulin molecules in the right granules we find in the cells that we make. And up until this time, no one has been able to make that kind of cell. We've gone on to show by various sorts of assays that these cells respond multiple times to a glucose challenge and secrete the right amount of insulin, kind of like breakfast, lunch, and dinner. We give it glucose, high level, it secretes insulin. Low glucose, it turns off insulin. We've done that many times. The other thing we've done is, when we started on this, we set ourselves two challenges, which I'm glad about in retrospect, but which caused a lot of I would say, discomfort in the lab over these years. The first challenge was that we would only do this with human cells. This is both more expensive and more tedious, and many of you will know caused a huge amount of wasting my time with enormous amounts of arguments with the Congress and how to fund it. But since I wanted to do it for humans, we set off saying we will only study this on human cells. And the second thing we did, which is a little less obvious, is we set off to do it, how would I describe it, at scale. The scientists in the room will know that you're often accustomed to reading a paper which will show a beautiful micrograph of 1 or 5 or 10 cells. But a human being has 1 billion beta cells, so we set off to grow these cells at scale rather than doing it in a small-scale dish grown in planar culture. We did the latter part by growing them in these spinner tissue culture flasks. I put this coffee cup here just to give you an idea of the size of it. This has a little magnetic stir bar at the bottom, and we grow, and I'll show you a little movie of this, these cells while they're spinning around in clusters. And here's a section through one of the clusters. And so you can see two things here, that many but not all of the cells are insulin-expressing cells. So this would be one cell. This cluster would have about 1,000 to 5,000 cells in it. So they're like spheres growing in this suspension. And I'll come back later to what these blue cells are, which are not insulin-positive cells. Some of them are glucagon-expressing cells, some of them are somatostatin, but most of them are either stuck progenitors or some other cell type that we haven't fully characterized. I brought this movie because I like it, and for a couple of reasons. One is the movie was made by an undergraduate, and when I did my PhD at the MRC lab of molecular biology in Cambridge, there were no undergraduates in the lab. Some of you will know it's very separate from the college. And one of the things I like at Harvard is that the faculty all have undergraduates working in their lab. And this undergraduate, Mikey Siegel, had as his senior thesis as an undergraduate, making functional human beta cells from embryonic stem cells. And I say this in part to make fun of Harvard, because I thought this thesis should win the number one prize for Harvard undergraduates, and I made every argument I could. Instead, the thesis was given for some weird reinterpretation of Shakespeare, like reading it through red glasses or something. But it just drove me crazy that this thesis did not win the best undergraduate prize. Anyway, let me show you the little movie Mikey made. So here just gives you an idea of the scale of it. This is the flask. There you see a person's hand. And you might be able to see, we'll see it in a minute. This is the rate at which these cells grow, beginning with single cells. Within 24 hours, they make clusters the size of human islets. And then here you can see, I think you can see it's kind of clouded. They're little white spheres or clusters spinning around in there. And the point is that what you're looking at there in those 6 flasks are enough human beta cells to treat 6 people. So this has been really the changing event in the last few months. Here I'm showing you a picture where the insulin-producing cells are stained in green. The alpha cells, or glucagon cells, are stained in red. And these cells were transplanted into a mouse with diabetes and can rescue their blood sugar control. And this also allows me to point out things that we haven't solved yet, is there are blue cells here, and so in here, that are not producing insulin and not producing glucagon. And those are cells we have to get better control over. We don't know what they're doing. Here's our first experiments done with Jose Oberhauser in Chicago, transplanting these cells into monkeys. And so I would summarize this part by saying, I'm confident now that we've reached the point where we can make or tell human embryonic stem cells to become beta cells. What we have to do now is figure out how to transplant them into people, to relieve them of their blood glucose checks and insulin injections. And many of you will know that requires dealing with the immune system. Simply put, we have to now figure out how to make those cells both survive and function after transplantation. We haven't solved that problem. I put it here as a next step, blocking the immune tech in type 1. But I thought I'd share with you some very encouraging preliminary results we've obtained with Dan Anderson, a bioengineer at MIT. So Dan has developed a chemically modified alginate which prevents fibroblasts and mesenchymal cells from sort of glomming over any artificial device you put into a person or to put into an animal. This chemically modified alginate is then deposited around the islets, shown here as these little microcapsules. And we now have these microcapsules inside a fully immune-competent rodent for 7 months, which has not lost any of the survival of these cells. The animals are still maintained on human insulin. And so we're very encouraged by this sort of first step advance. Second problem will be, of course, dealing with the reasonable questions from regulatory agencies, which is, are those alginate particles safe? The problem with this experiment is we just deposit them into the peritoneum, so they're floating around the body cavity of the animals. And so we probably need to figure out some retrievable device. You could imagine, for example, putting an iron particle in and then calling them out with a magnet, or putting them in some kind of larger, like fishnet sort of teabag device. And these are the ideas we're now considering as we move more into that area. But on this part, I wanted to leave you with this sort of simple-minded diagram. I use the term simple-minded. It sort of annoys me in a way. I do think I am simple-minded. I like very simple approaches to things. But many of the grants I submit are sent back that they are simple-minded and overly ambitious. And so sometimes I have to think of a way of making this to sound more sophisticated. But it's not a very sophisticated idea. Diabetics have defective or missing beta cells. The kind of cell Sir Martin Evans discovered can make any cell in the body. We figured out how to turn that into a pancreatic beta cell, and I don't mean to say that it's game over there. We have to improve on the efficiency, do more tests on these non-beta cells, but we've now demonstrated that this can be done. We want to put them in an immunoprotective device and then rescue people from not only the complications they suffer from diabetes, but the monotonous and daily requirement to watch what they eat, how much exercise they do, measure their blood, and inject themselves with insulin. And if I'm lucky enough to come back in another 10 years, maybe I can describe those experiments to you. I could tell you now about this same simple-minded approach of taking an embryonic stem cell and turning it into a cell that's missing from work that I know best at the Harvard Stem Cell Institute for a number of different kinds of cells. We have a very active program making dopaminergic neurons for Parkinson's. We're trying to make functional kidney cells, certain kinds of skin cells. The largest group there is really focused on making hematopoietic stem cells. But I thought I'd show you one sort of funny example of using these cells to think more about the next challenge, which would be beyond making a cell, how would you make a tissue? So this is an experiment I like, done by Professor Ott. And what you're looking at here is a rat's heart. So let's say you wanted to make a heart, a new human heart. Well, obviously, just making the cardiomyocyte, the heart cell, is not sufficient. There are lots of different kinds of cells in the heart, but the bigger issue is how do you get them to form the right shape? And I should have emphasized that in the case of diabetes, that's a big advantage we have. The glucose molecule is small, the insulin molecule is small, and the cell will work in other places in the body. So you don't have to make a structure like an eye or a heart. So how would you make a heart? Well, this experiment I like, because as Harold Ott tells me about it, they first wanted to begin with the sort of bones, if you will, of the heart, the kind of carcass of a heart, which provides the non-living extracellular matrix, and then seed that with stem cells. And so they worked a long time on how do you decellularize the heart, get rid of all the living material. And you can see here the stages of that process going from left to right. And as Harold describes it, or maybe it was a student in his lab, they spent a lot of time with very expensive and sophisticated chemicals only to discover that Dawn dish detergent or Joy works quite well. I think they said, I think Dawn works better. And so they just soak this rat's heart in this dish detergent and it decellularizes it, leaving this ghost here at the end, which I want to emphasize has no cells. That structure, if you would, like the 2x4s or the walls of a house, can then be seeded with human embryonic cells that are cardiomyocytes. And here's a nice little movie of that, where you have a rat's heart now pumping like you see on the TV shows. I'm not a medic, so I don't know what these different things at the bottom, but there's some kind of cardiogram that are showing a pumping heart. So I showed this to my daughter, to which she nicely responded, "Great, Dad, that's all we need is more rats." You know, so This, of course, is the first step, though, in thinking about how would you make human tissues and organs. So Harold and his colleagues have kept a rat alive with this artificial heart for 2 hours. Okay, so where does this go in the longer term? Well, I've emphasized trying to work on these various degenerative diseases. These are the diseases which we at the Harvard Stem Cell Institute feel we have an idea about how to proceed. It would be making forebrain neurons, midbrain neurons, motor neurons, muscle cells, and as I described for you, pancreatic beta cells. I want to shift gears now. We can come back and talk about how you would make normal tissues and organs, but I want to shift now to use a stem cell not as something you'd put back in a person, but as a tool or a reagent to understand why people get these diseases. So you remember I talked to you about them being multigenic and having environmental influences, and I think it's fair to say that even with all of the power of DNA sequencing, we haven't really made any progress, certainly in terms of treatments for any of these diseases, by trying to understand only the genetics, and we're, as a community, not getting far at all on the environmental signals. This work is made possible by another of the people whose names I showed you earlier, Shinya Yamanaka, who found a way of taking an adult cell and turning it back into a stem cell, a so-called IPS, or induced pluripotent stem cell. So the plan that we've been pursuing at Harvard, as has been at other places, is to take skin cells from patients, reprogram them to make patient-specific cells, IPS cells, and then study the differentiation, not with the view of putting those cells back in the patient, because remember, the patient already has defective cells, but use them to figure out the causes of disease. And I'm going to show you here some nice work from Kevin Agin and Lee Rubin, and you can watch for yourself. I'm showing you a time course of a little less than a week of two dishes, one in which has had motor neurons made from a person with ALS, and one of which has had motor neurons made from a person that does not have ALS, amyotrophic lateral sclerosis. And so what you're going to watch then is the development and growth of these motor neurons over a period of a week. Actually, this may take too long, so I'm going to speed it up and show you the end of the week. Let's stop that one there. And stop that one there. So I think it's pretty obvious that on the right, you're looking at motor neurons from a person that has a disease, and there's a strict and obvious correlation. There are fewer cells, and these nice little fibrils, the axons of the neurons, are deficient. You see many more of them here, hardly any of them here. This wonderful result, in a way, did not have to be true. It could have been that it would take decades to see a phenotype outside of the body. And yet, scientists are very fortunate that this defective phenotype appears in a petri dish. This enables us then to go about doing screening in the first instance to ask what drugs could you give to the cells on the right so that they survive longer and look more like the normal cells on the left. And that's where Lee Rubin's therapeutic screening center comes in. Here you can see one example where you're looking for more green or more red in the presence of a chemical. And Lee recently reported on this chemical as leading to extensive survival of motor neurons from patients, not in patients, but motor neurons derived from patients that suffer from SMA, spinal muscular atrophy, which is a very similar motor neuron disease. Kevin and Lee and their colleagues are excited now in that they have two other drugs going into clinical trials for ALS now. And I'm not here to tell you that that disease is about to be cured. I'm more here to say that this is a way forward on trying to study diseases where you cannot get the cell or tissue out of the patient, and you cannot easily figure out what is the root cause of that disease. But by watching the disease phenotype, as it were, occur in the laboratory, we can now begin to try to understand how we might intervene and do something about it. And I want to emphasize the point here. The idea is not to get, say, forebrain basal neurons from a person with Alzheimer's and put them back into the patient. They're not going to recover their memory by that. It's rather to slow the process of these degenerative diseases. And in biology, it's not so hard to slow processes by a factor of 2 or 4 or maybe even 10. And that could make a huge difference to patients that are suffering from these diseases, which take long periods of time to show their full effect. And as I said before, my wife, who's had to listen to me from time to time, has said, by now, everyone is so depressed they want to leave because all you've talked about is all the diseases they're going to get and how long it's going to take to cure them. So recently, I've been adding a kind of coda to my talks, not on my work, but on the work of Amy Wagers and Rich Lee and others, which has to do with aging, and particularly with healthy aging. So I'm going to end and switch to that now with the argument that one could think about harnessing stem cell biology for aging. And I can even admit, in a kind of self-indulgent or personal way, about how I started thinking about aging. I've been blessed with very good health, and I never really go to the doctor. And when I turned 50, my wife said, no, you really have to go to the doctor. And so I've been going for a few years. And I want my doctor, like a good schoolboy, I want my doctor to say, I'm doing well, I'm getting an A, that I'm in very good shape. And all he ever says is, you are in very good shape for a man of your age. That's all he ever said. So I saw this cartoon, which I quite like. For those in the back who can't read it, it says, at your age, good health is pretty much a thing of the past. My advice is, find an illness you'll enjoy. Okay. Now, we can laugh at that because we pretty much all think that this is a sort of fact of life, that as you age, most of your functions are going to decline. I won't ask the more senior people in the audience to tell us which of their functions have declined and which they are most concerned about. But it happens to all of us in different ways. I, for example, like to ride my bike a lot. And I know when I fall off my bike now, I remember it for a long time. But I also remember as a little boy falling off 3 or 4 times a day, and I didn't even remember it the next day. So we all know about this natural process of aging. And if we think about what we want, I'm sorry, it's cut off a bit there at the top. It says most people want to increase their health span rather than just their lifetime. That is the time that they will feel healthy. So if scientists could say, we're going to keep you longer, will alive for much longer, but you're going to have Alzheimer's and type 2 diabetes and maybe have to do kidney transplant or perfusion. Most people don't want to go for that. So I think people in general would be happy to settle for an even shorter life if they were healthier during that entire period. And as I was preparing for the talk, I was thinking about something my grandmother said to me, who passed away, when we used to have arguments about God, because my grandmother's extremely Catholic, and when the embryonic stem cell work came to the fore, I had to defend myself a lot with her. And one of the things we talked about was God, in her view, control of life. And she said something I thought was quite funny that I remembered. She said, well, if there really was a God, you would live a healthy life until the day you died. I thought that was a sort of nice idea. Why shouldn't we aim to be healthy and vibrant for most of our life? I don't mean not change, but be healthy for a longer period and not have to suffer this red curve here, which I tried to frighten you all about later. And I do know the Marshall scholars here are not thinking about that because they're up here, and most people are thinking, well, that might be true for the older people in the room, but it won't happen to me. Well, you'll wait and see if it does happen to you. Okay. So, as I told you, I give lectures to undergraduates, it's very hard to get an undergraduate interested in aging. That is like the last thing on their mind, right? So I found a good little picture to talk about that. So here's a picture of a woman who's about an undergraduate in age, and now you're going to watch what happens to her as she ages. So you see here that obviously her hair's changed color, her skin is sagging a bit, she still has green eyes, and I'm glad to say still has her nice smile. But we all know that lots of changes have occurred. I'll show you that again. So you can think about, we all even like to look through our own family album. And I know when I look at myself, I can't believe that was me, because I somehow think I still look like that, but I don't, right? So what are the characteristics of aging? Well, obviously, as one's young, your organs are much more robust, your wounds heal very rapidly, and there's a higher tissue turnover rate. This has been demonstrated for many tissues now, and that should remind you of what I talked about earlier about these stem cells. And these things decline as one ages. Organs become more frail, wounds heal more slowly, there's a lower tissue turnover rate. we can talk afterward, if you like, about whether or not scientists should have the goal of immortality, but I think we can at least agree that scientists should think about trying to slow the process of aging. And for this talk, I was very happy to find, I tried to look up references with my friend Rich Lee about this idea for this wonderfully simple experiment that I'm going to show you, which involves sewing together a young animal and an old animal, a process called parabiosis, to look for a factor in young animals. And there's this very nice reference to this many of you here will be happy to see. The first scientific volume, I would say in the first scientific journal ever, the Philosophical Transactions from 1666, has an article in it, and you can try to read it there. It's not in Welsh, but it's not exactly in regular English either. But the question was whether if you took blood from an old dog and put it in a young dog, if you took blood from a young dog and put it in an old dog, what effect would that have on an old dog? So the idea, of course, that there are humors in our blood dates back to the time of Aristotle, that the blood is the source of many things in life, both evil and positive humors. But in terms of an experimental protocol, this is an interesting one, whether by transfusing blood you could rejuvenate an old dog. So Professor Rondo and Amy Wagers and their colleagues did this experiment some years ago, and I used to show a real picture of these mice. I've learned not to do that. And so in this experiment, one is taking two mice, a young mouse and an old mouse, and sewing them together, and they then exchange their blood. And I can just tell you, as far as we can tell, though mice aren't very talkative, they don't have any real problem with this. They still try to mate, they eat at a regular, they do not lose weight. So they run around the cage sewn together. And I'll remind you that they're treated extremely well. There are no cats in our mouse facility. They have unlimited amounts of food. Someone changes their bed for them every day. So they're not really suffering from this. And the experiment, which I summarize here, comes back to what I was saying a bit, I guess, about riding a bike and falling off. Here's the control for that experiment. Y is young and O is old. So two mice sewn together, the muscle is injured in the thigh of one of the young mice, and the amount of red cells here represents the amount of muscle repair. So this control experiment shows that sewing the mice together has had no effect on the rapid repair of the muscle following injury. An important experiment here, which is good news for old people, is that if you take an old mouse and a young mouse and sew them together and injure the young mouse can still repair its muscle quite well. So at a superficial level, this argues against the idea that as you age, all of the smoking and drinking and other bad things you've done have created so many toxins that you are preventing muscle repair. That's not it. It's because the young mouse can still repair. It is implied here, of course, is that there's something missing. Here are two old mice put together. There's the rate of repair in an old mouse. And here's the key result. This is all of the repair in an old mouse as a consequence of having shared its blood with a young animal. So the young blood contains factors that stimulate stem cells to make more muscle in an old animal. Rich Lee and Amy went on to show another version of this, which I won't explain in so much detail, which is that as the heart ages, it becomes less elastic and enlarges. And to everyone's surprise, by pairing an old mouse with a young mouse, the old heart became smaller, more elastic, and performed much better in these very sophisticated cardiac tests. You can see here, maybe a little bit, here's the size of an old heart, and here's the size of an old heart after it's been paired with a young animal. The last example of this project has to do with thinking about our brain. So the question is, can you rejuvenate an aged brain by factors from young blood? And this would be a new way to think about treating neurodegenerative disease, to slow the degeneration that I've mentioned in Alzheimer's, Parkinson's, and other cases. So nerve and vessel defects are known to combine to reduce cognitive ability, especially in Alzheimer's, for example. There's a very strong correlation. So Lee Rubin and Amy worked to put young blood into an old animal and showed that an old brain that is exposed to young blood has many more endothelial cells and performs much better on numerous functions. Now that alone would be really quite spectacular if this group hadn't gone on to show that what the young blood provides is not a cell, but something in the blood, a factor in the blood. And to a first approximation, we now know that one of the factors which can reproduce all of the things of this young blood is a factor I expect you're going to hear more and more about, called growth and differentiation factor 11, GDF11. So this increases the number of nerve cells in the brain, it increases the number of vessels and blood flow, it increases neural activity, and it improves the behavior of these mice in an old animal. So I'm not here to be able to tell you, you can now sign up for this and fix yourself at the age you're at now. Although for those of you who are a little younger, I would say you shouldn't want to be fixed yet, because there's a lot of things you'll learn how to do better as you get a little older. But I might summarize before I end with the main points of what I tried to argue today. These are the things I guess I would like you to remember. The first, there's an amazing potential in all your cells. That should make you feel good about yourself. That your cells contain, many of your cells contain all the information to make other cell types in your body. That we should now think more seriously about using stem cells to replace cells and tissues which are damaged either by injury or disease. I described the way of using stem cells from the skin of a patient turned into an iPS cell, which can then be used to help find drugs that may eventually stop or slow degenerative diseases. It won't cure them, but it could be an enormous benefit to people who suffer from these degenerative diseases. And I talked about what I would call the prospects for healthy aging, thinking about the inevitability of aging in a slightly different way. And I have three sort of thank you slides, or one maybe publicity slide. For the Marshall scholars in the room, I would say, and other young scholars, if you're interested in this kind of work, Cardiff is a great place, but Harvard is a good place too. And Harvard at the moment has the highest concentration, I would argue, in the world of stem cell scientists. We've created a collaborative with all of these institutions. It has over 1,000 scientists, more than 90 labs work together on these different projects. And so if you're thinking about pursuing this kind of work, I'd be surprised if you couldn't find someone at Harvard that was doing interesting things. Importantly, on the diabetes work I talked about today, I want to give credit to the people who've done this with me in my lab, and they're listed here. And by a wonderful coincidence, the first author on the paper that was just published, Felicia Paluca, was a Marshall Scholar at Cambridge before she came to my lab for her postdoc. And lastly, I want to thank the Marshall Aid Commemoration Commission. It really did change my life. I hope it will have such an effect on all the Marshall Scholars here. And I'm really honored that they would ask me, of all of the people they could ask, to come and give a lecture. It's delightful to be here in Cardiff, and thank you for your attention. I tried to reserve some time. I think John and Mary thought we could have questions. I'm glad to answer questions now. Yes?
The stuff with the beta cells is really interesting. The scale up for animal experiments is slightly easier, but what about the scale up for a population? It would be a big financial challenge. What are your thoughts?
You mean the human population? Yes. Well, I have a lot of thoughts about that. I mean, one is the good thing you could say is that this is a disease which has many patients and therefore has an enormous market. And so there should be resources that could be diverted or invested into scaling up to treat people. The challenge there for our pharmaceutical industries, in my experience, is they are very good at thinking about pills in a bottle. Nobody really sells cells as a product. So if what you meant by that, do I imagine that you would go to a local pharmacy and then squirt the cells in? You know, I'm thinking more that there will be clinics where you would go in the first instance to get a packet of cells that are probably not your own cells and are in an immunoprotective device. But with iPS technology, it's very reasonable to imagine that you, if you became an insulin-dependent type 2 diabetic, you could go to a clinic, have blood drawn. And now we're down to 8 weeks, we will have an iPS cell from your blood. In another 2 or 3 months, we can make the beta cell. So let's say 6 to 8 months later, come back for a dollop or a packet of your own beta cells. I'm not the right person to ask about the financial aspects of that, but in terms of the cost to humanity, it's certainly justified. And I'll bet people will be able to figure out a way to make a business out of it as well. Is that what you meant by scaling up? Yes. So I do not think this is a technology which is only going to be available to a few people. My vision would be, or great hope would be, that it would be available to any diabetic. I know at the moment, from some boards on which I sit, that the people who sell insulin are not thinking much about Europe or the US. They consider that a mature market. Their eyes are on selling insulin in India and China, because they can already make the product. It's just a case of marketing it and selling it. So I think this is more likely to be developed in the first instance in North America or in Europe. Maybe that's more answer than you wanted, but that's how I think about it. Yeah. Yes?
How often would a patient have to be treated with a packet of cells?
That's a good question, and we don't know the answer. I can just wave my hands at it by saying that the half-life of beta cells in a human is quite long, as I said, many, many months. We have animals now out more than a half of a year. So I would say a minimum, based on animal work, would be a half a year, which I can tell you from knowing many type 1 diabetics, that if I said to them, you have to go in twice a year for a packet of cells, but you won't be pricking your finger 10 times a day and injecting insulin, that's a pretty good bargain. If you ask my intuition, it'll be that those cells will last for a few years, but not forever. The size of the packet, I might have said, by our calculations, but these are very rough, would be something like this, a very thin, flat disc, like the as thin as a pound note, and about that big, should be enough for one person. And we don't know where to put it yet, whether we'd put it in the peritoneum. Many people think about between the shoulder blades, the intrascapular region, and the omentum. These are things we'll be exploring in the next few years. Yes?
You have this lovely protocol for making the beta cells derived from your knowledge in developmental biology. And then you said, obviously it's a very involved procedure. It lasts a long time. You need lots of different factors. And you'd like to streamline that. Mm. Do you imagine that will come from further investigations of developmental biology, or do you think it can mix and match the knowledge you already have?
I think it'll be more the latter. Clearly you know a lot about this. I'll just tell you, we've been doing a lot of single cell sequencing on all of the steps and are now getting a pretty good path about how cells make decisions at what stage and when they take a left turn and get stuck. And those give us then clues about what signaling pathways we should tweak. But commercially, we've got to stop spending money on growth factors. So if you run a lab, you will know that last year I spent $200,000 on activin alone. That was one of 15 factors on that thing. So we have got to get around the high cost of growth factors using small molecules. And as you clearly know, there are, for example, small molecule agonists and antagonists for hedgehogs and other pathways. So I think that's the future of it. But more to your question, I would say, most of what we did, I'm sorry to tell you, was not because of thinking very hard. It was really trial and error. In fact, when we published our paper, this one reporter who essentially was driving me crazy, she asked me again and again, why did it take 15 years? And I finally just said, I don't know, maybe we're stupid. Maybe someone else could have done it faster. It took us 15 years because it was a lot of guessing and trial and error. So, and I think that's what's going to happen in the next phase. Yes.
In the parabiotic experiments, were there any notable complications, for example, like the growth of hidden neoplasms in the older patients suddenly because you had an injection that affected the younger mouse?
There weren't, but I don't know that the mice were kept together long enough to really see that. And moreover, since it wasn't an object of the study, they didn't go looking for any neoplasms. But there was nothing obvious that happened. And these are using syngeneic mice, right? So it would be interesting to think about what you could learn about cancers. If that kind of thing interests you, you might have seen these papers I find quite interesting about the Tasmanian devil and the dogs, where you can bite another animal and transfer cancer. I think that's really quite cool. Not that one should do it for fun, but it's interesting that you could get a cancer by being bitten. Yes, well, again, let me thank you all for taking the afternoon with me, and thanks to the Marshall Aid Commemoration Commission again. Thank you, John and Mary.